Disclaimer: the following views are mine alone and do not represent the views of my employer. If you've spent any time in Iowa, it is likely you've heard a local proudly proclaim that we are Iowa nice. While there is no actual definition of Iowa nice, in practice it means that we are overly friendly and go out of our way to help our fellow citizens. Iowa nice means that we pull over on the side of the road to help a stranger change a tire. However, Iowa nice has caused the city of Des Moines, and the state of Iowa, to slow progressive ideals that were once the cornerstone of the state. Before my current position, my knowledge about local government was limited to the NBC sitcom Parks and Recreation. However, I came to realize that my ignorance to civic engagement was not unique, but rather an endemic to the populace. Des Moines, Iowa was a once beacon of progress throughout not only the state but also the U.S. In 1948, civil rights pioneer Edna Griffin organized a series of sit-ins and boycotts at Katz Drugstore in downtown Des Moines. This was 7 years before Rosa Parks refused to give up her seat in 1955. The Des Moines Human Rights Commission was established in 1951, more than a decade before Lyndon B. Johnson signed the Civil Rights Act of 1964. Same-sex marriage was legally recognized by the state of Iowa in 2009, 6 years before Obergefell v. Hodges legalized it across America. So what happened? Civic engagement at the local level has a greater impact on the everyday lives of citizens than anything occurring in D.C. under Donald Trump or Barack Obama. If not for people in small communities voicing their opinions to their leaders, we would be in a constant state of stagnation. While everyone may not agree with the institution of federalism, it undeniably allows constituents to voice their opinions to local leaders who have the power to affect the laws and policies where they live. If Iowa nice is a characteristic of our communities, why doesn't Iowa nice translate into municipal or state policy? On November 15, 2016, the Des Moines School Board responded to a student demonstration protesting the election. This meeting was standing room only, and after leaving, I felt a sense of pride, because Des Moines had shown up to support its students and their beliefs. The meeting concluded with the school board declaring that they stood with the teachers and students who protested the election. The student demonstration and support from the community resulted in a school board vote passing a resolution to declare the Des Moines Public Schools a sanctuary district. This was the best instance of civic engagement I can remember from the past year. However, far too often, less than 5 people attend city meetings that are open for public comment. If no one shows up to inform local leadership about issues in the city, how can city leaders be expected to resolve problems they do not know about? There are numerous issues in the city that are not being actively addressed. Despite the flurry of development in the downtown area, there continues to be slum housing conditions that primarily impact the refugee and immigrant population, while Black or African American households in Polk County continue to earn an average of $33,119 less than the median household income in the county. Allowing members of the Des Moines community to endure substandard housing and failing to address the earnings gap isn't very nice. Has it somehow become mean to speak out and pressure elected officials to help change a flat tire in the name of progress? Iowa nice has led to complacency and an expectation that issues needing to be addressed will be handled by our local leaders. But when our leaders are focusing their attention on economic development that wins Des Moines numerous awards, how can they be expected to address systemic issues of inequality? There is currently very little political pressure placed on local leadership to address these issues. The Des Moines City Council is elected by the people of Des Moines to represent the ideals of their constituents. However, when the biggest problem these leaders are forced to address is the placement of a bike lane, then maybe it is not the leaders who are failing but instead the people who are too nice to point out where the city's policies are failing. In last November's general election, Hillary Clinton received over 26,000 more votes than Donald Trump in Polk County. If a majority of the residents in Des Moines are progressive, then why are residents of Des Moines failing to take action and instead relying on city leaders to act for us? On Monday, October 9, 2017 at 4 p.m., the Des Moines City Council will be discussing an inclusivity proclamation. The purpose of this proclamation is to notify undocumented residents that the City of Des Moines Police Department recognizes the power to regulate immigration remains exclusive to the federal government, and the DMPD will not assist ICE. This proclamation does not establish Des Moines as a sanctuary city. While any policy coming out of City Council may only have power within the City of Des Moines, the impact that a unified voice and vision has in the state's capital cannot be ignored. The principles of Iowa Nice should be reflected in the actions of state leaders who are elected to reflect and represent the beliefs of their constituency. Welcoming city and inclusivity proclamations would do wonders in small communities in Iowa that heavily rely on an immigrant workforce. It is our duty and responsibility as the capital of Iowa to show these communities they have support here in Des Moines. Helping those who are in need of assistance is the Iowa Nice thing to do. Des Moines, I guess what I am trying to tell you is stop being so damn nice. Though the devastation in Puerto Rico has faded to the background somewhat in recent days, the region is not nearly out of the woods. According to data reported by FEMA on Wednesday, only half of the island has access to drinking water and only 5% has electricity. Recent numbers reported by a status site put up by the PR governor's office has electricity at 9.2% now. It's absolutely crucial to keep these numbers in the conversation so the public is aware of the ongoing issues Puerto Rico are facing. As attention fades, so does activism, aid, and accountability. Curiously, as the Washington Post reported, FEMA deleted this information from their website yesterday. William Buher, a FEMA spokesman, told the Post that the deleted data was still being listed on the aforementioned website of the governor of Puerto Rico, Ricardo Rossello. The site reporting the data is not a known destination for anyone outside of Puerto Rico. In other words, they're trying to hide the numbers, they're trying to push the story to the sidelines. As the Post pointed out, the only information left on the FEMA site lauds the government's actions by listing their accomplishments thus far. They are attempting to swing the narrative by deifying the federal response and erasing the harsh reality of the situation. FEMA has offered no rationale for deleting the info because the rationale is obvious: they don't want these numbers readily accessible by the public. They want to continue to move at the pace they believe is sufficient, and they don't want the pesky public weighing in with their thoughts. With all that is going on between North Korea, the shooting in Las Vegas, tax reform, DACA, healthcare, and whatever tweet the president is set to unleash on the public next, the rebuilding process in Puerto Rico is a prime candidate to take a backseat. Keep checking status.pr and keep raising awareness, because now is the time when a truly spectacular failure can occur. Now is the time where resources can be diverted, and disaster capitalism, a term coined by Naomi Klein in her book The Shock Doctrine, can take over and turn a catastrophe into a corporate free-for-all that laces the pockets of opportunistic CEOs. Never underestimate the federal government's ability to exploit a disaster via privatization. It happens time and time again. Elements of the recovery and rebuilding efforts will almost certainly be privatized and outsourced to U.S. corporations, and Puerto Rico will be far worse off for it. We need to keep paying attention in order to hold those in power accountable. Don't let FEMA erase the problems of Puerto Rico. Previously published on The Overgrown. Follow at JMechanic, like, at Jesse Ian Mechanic. What is the worst thing you've ever done? Now imagine being known by that one mistake regardless of what you've done to take responsibility or make amends. You have to write it on the top of every application for employment or housing you ever fill out for the rest of your life. Labels are powerful, and our society has plenty for people who have been through the criminal justice system and have the record to show for it: felon, offender, convict, criminal. Even inmate casts a dark shadow in its rightful context. An inmate is just a number identified by numbers on a uniform. Personhood is revoked. When we call people offenders and convicts, we identify them by what they have done, not by their basic human dignity. But why does it really matter what people with a criminal history are called? It turns out that the labels aren't primarily a matter of political correctness, but of public safety. The land of the free incarcerates more people than any country in the world, almost 2.2 million, according to the Bureau of Justice Statistics. 95% of those in state prisons will be released, facing widespread social stigma and legal restrictions that hinder them from giving back to society. Check out some of the most outrageous ones here. And every year, prisons release 600,000 people back into their communities. That's a lot of people to relegate to the fringes of society, even after their debt is paid. And the labels we give them have the power to change how they think about themselves and their potential. When someone can never shake the label offender, it's as if the time or work they put into paying their debt means nothing, says Heather Rice Minus, Vice President of Government Affairs at Prison Fellowship. Prison Fellowship holds to the belief that all people have God-given value, dignity, and the potential to change. People are not the sum of their worst choices. As an organization and as a community, we want our language to reflect that, to lend to a culture that helps people with a criminal record in making important contributions to society and living up to their God-given potential. And everybody's story is different. Randy Anderson, who served time in prison on drug charges, now works as an addiction counselor at the same facility where he began his journey to recovery. Read more of his story here. Christopher Pulo's story took a turn in high school. First came the prescription drugs. Later it was cocaine, felony charges, and 2.5 years in federal prison. Grappling with addiction behind bars, he entered a recovery program and took every step to prepare for a productive life on the outside. Upon his release, he found a job, continued his recovery, and even went to law school, serving with task forces on addiction and criminal justice policy. He managed to pass the bar after an unusually lengthy and strenuous process, and today he serves as executive director at an addiction treatment center. But like hordes of other returning citizens written off as ex-offenders and criminals, Christopher faced roadblocks because of his felony record applied, he compares to serving a life sentence. When other people identify me using strongly stigmatizing terms such as felon, addict, junkie, drug abuser, or convict, it immediately places me in the category of being other, says Christopher. Putting X in front of any of those terms does not effectively mitigate the harm. I can't speak for others, but I imagine that for some people, stigmatizing language has similar effects on them that it has had on me. I have seen a lot of people put themselves in a box, limiting their own future potential, because of their pasts. Gina Evans has found this to be true throughout her recovery journey, too. The Minnesota mom found freedom from meth addiction and now works at a rehab and recovery center to help others find healing from life-controlling issues. Once you have that scarlet letter on your forehead that says felon, everything becomes difficult, says Evans. But God brought me through all the things I've been through for such a time as this, to bring hope and help to others. My kids have their mom back, my mom has her daughter back. Thoughtful language is about recognizing the perceptions that language so powerfully reinforces, for good or for bad. It's about affording dignity to those who wish to reclaim their identity as people. Not junkies or addicts, but people who struggle with addiction. Not offenders or convicts, but incarcerated men and women. Not ex-cons or criminals, but returning citizens. How we label people directly affects how we choose to invest in them during their incarceration and after their release. If we see those who break the law as criminals, offenders, and nothing more, we are less inclined to believe in their capability to change. The same labels affect the way people with a criminal record view themselves. They wonder, can I ever be part of the community? Do I have something to contribute? Am I important? And what they believe about themselves will affect how they approach the journey forward. Language contributes to a culture of hope. Poor terminology can have a negative effect, not just on the incarcerated men and women who are trying to change, but on the healing process of those who have suffered because of crime. That's why some people prefer survivor instead of victim, or drop the label altogether to say harmed party or person who has been harmed by crime. It's not about being politically correct. It's about being conscious of the weight of our words and helping people begin to reclaim their true identities wherever they are on their journey. And wherever that may be, they matter. A corrections officer once wondered how those under her supervision would like to be known. If it were up to them, how might they be called? She asked, and the group offered various answers: inmate, prisoner, resident. Then the corrections officer said, "What about just woman?" They all acted surprised. They hadn't even considered that one. "You may be a man or woman in prison today," says Heather Rice Minus, "but we are all sons and daughters together at the foot of the cross. Your identity is a child of God. You are capable, through Christ, of transformation. Our worst days do not define us. This is not about ignoring the crime and what the person owes for that wrong. It's about holding people accountable, while recognizing that there is nothing any of us can do to separate us from the love of God and the human dignity He bestowed upon each of us." Seth Meyers had some fun at Rex Tillerson's expense over Morongate on Thursday's late night. Meyers ridiculed the Secretary of State's press conference in which he pushed back on a report that he'd called President Donald Trump a moron over the summer. Tillerson did not deny using the term. "To think a guy's a moron and then be forced to publicly say he's smart," said Meyers, while shaking his head in disbelief. But the comedian did have a theory why Tillerson appeared to acquiesce so easily. "I guess when your name is Rex, you're gonna be good at rolling over," he joked. Good boy, Rex. Good boy. Check out the full segment above. Special Counsel Robert Mueller, the former FBI director investigating possible connections between Russian officials and President Donald Trump's campaign team, is now reportedly looking into a scandalous dossier containing explosive, unverified allegations regarding Trump and his associates. CNN and NBC News reported Thursday that Mueller's investigators have spoken to Christopher Steele, the former British spy who compiled the dossier. A separate report by Reuters said Mueller's team had taken over the FBI's inquiries into the dossier as part of the special counsel's investigation into whether Trump associates had colluded with Russian officials to influence the 2016 election. The document, which Trump was informed about shortly before his inauguration by then FBI Director James Comey, alleges compromising details about the president and his ties to Russia, including claims that Trump associates did indeed collude with Russians. It also alleges that Russian officials are sitting on damaging information about the president, including accusations that Trump hired a number of prostitutes to perform a golden showers, urination, show in front of him while staying in a hotel suite in Moscow that was under surveillance by Russian intelligence. The dossier's claims have not been substantiated, and Trump has vehemently denied the allegations, calling them totally made-up stuff. According to the CNN report, U.S. intelligence officials took the claims alleged in the document more seriously than previously indicated. The Senate Intelligence Committee has also attempted to contact Steele about the dossier, Committee Chairman Richard Burr, RN.C, said Wednesday. "Unfortunately, the committee has hit a wall," Burr said. "The committee cannot really decide the credibility of the dossier without understanding who paid for it, who are your sources and subsources." Burr added that he hopes Steele will eventually decide to meet with the committee.